We want to, I wasn't sure if we wanted to like bring this up on the podcast, but do we want to tell everybody like the big surprise?
What's the big surprise?
This is pretty cool of us, but like, you're free to do whatever you want with this script, everybody. If you want to film this script, yeah, we're giving you all the rights, all the ability to do whatever you want. This is for you all. This
Creative
is like, we're not precious
domain.
About it. This script is public domain as far as we're concerned. So feel free to shoot it.
Our gift to you.
Jar Jar. Portrait of a Hero.
Abridged!
As the roll-up continues, we hear the voice of Jar Jar Binks reading the text out loud.
It's a time of big danger for the Republic. The war with the Separatists rages on, and Nausa, more than ever, Wisa need real leaders with a real vision for the galaxy. Which is why Yusa should re-elect Misa, Jar Jar Binks, as your junior representative to the Galactic Senate. Misa fought the Trade Federation face first as Bombad General in the Battle of Naboo. And in Misa's first term, Misa worked side in hand with Senator Amidala for all the Nabooian peoples.
But most important, Misa was the only senator brave enough to grant emergency powers to Supreme Chancellor Palpatine. Misa proud to stand by the Chancellor in our fight to save the Republic, because the galaxy needs a hero, and so does Naboo.
And cut.
The roll-up grinds to an abrupt halt and scrolls back up. The roll-up is actually a holographic teleprompter floating in midair in the Senate offices of Jar Jar Binks. His silver protocol droid, N-838, dutifully hands him a pair of giant novelty vibro scissors.
That's where you cut the cord and the curtain drops, revealing a fabulous statue of you, sir.
The holographic projection shifts into an image of a statue hidden under a curtain. The curtain falls, revealing a statue of Jar Jar standing boldly atop a tank. An inscription at the bottom reads, "The Hero of Naboo."
Should we really say Misa, Hero of Naboo?
Don't ask me, Junior Representative Binks. Ask your constituents.
He opens the blinds. Outside in the courtyard below, a massive crowd of adoring fans screams and cheers for Jar Jar. They wave signs and banners. Jar Jar is our hero. Wisa heart Jar Jar, etc.
Aye, yikes. They's acting like Misa Bombad Jedi. But Misa just some any day kind of fella.
And that's why you're so inspiring. Only the chosen elite can swing a lightsaber, but anyone can be as brave as Jar Jar Binks. Now let's get out there and give the people what they want.
Jar Jar puts on a brave smile, hoists the scissors over his shoulder, and marches to the door.
Not the front door. The crowd will mob us like a pack of slitherfish. This way, sir.
Nate 38 opens the door, guarding Jar Jar behind her. Upon seeing Jar Jar exit his office, a commotion erupts in the line.
Jar Jar!
Jar Jar!
Jar Jar, Mr. Binks,
please read this petition.
Read this.
We need your help.
I'm hungry. Political stuff, Mr. Jar Jar.
No. No appointments today. The representative is very busy.
Groans of disappointment from the people in line.
Hi there, sorry. Can't Wisa do anything for them?
Oh, very well.
A hatch pops open in 838's chassis, and she fires a volley of campaign stickers at the people in line.
Sticker for you, sticker for you, sticker for you. Vote for Jar Jar.
General Jar Jar? Is it you?
Croquet?
Captain Croquet Seal, ready for battle.
So what are Yusa doing here?
Misa came to Theed to see you, but I guess Yusa pretty busy these days, huh?
Well, Misa here now, what's on your mind?
Well, General, Misa pumping their sludge runoff straight into the Andrevea River.
Misa what?
Captain Seal, it is my delight to inform you that every Republic facility on Naboo is thoroughly regulated to ensure minimal environmental impact.
Minimal impact, huh? Tell that to the folks in my village. Misa can't eat the fish. Misa can't sell the fish. Misa dying, General.
Captain Seal, the junior representative hears your concerns and thanks you for sharing your voice. May I suggest filing an official complaint with the subcommittee?
Those muckety wigs don't listen to us. Misa, minimal impact. But you, General.
Oh, Misa not that important, really.
General, Misa spilled the same blood in the same mud. Will Yusa fight for us?
Sorry, sir, this is our stop. A true pleasure to meet you, Captain. Vote for Jar Jar.
But Misa not... Yeah!
Jar Jar sweats nervously. The crowd outside, hyped beyond all reason, chants his name.
Then you'll give your speech. Cut the rope, reveal the statue, and then my Padawan will... Fringe, stop staring.
Sorry. It will be my distinct honor to protect you, Jar Jar.
Representative Binks.
Oh, Representative Binks! Sorry, I'm such a big fan, sir. You're kind of like my hero.
Misa, your hero? But Yusa Jedis, Yusa the heroes. All we do is protect the good guys and fight the bad guys.
That's not all we do.
We may have the Force, but you have the power to improve people's lives.
That's enough, Padawan. Why don't you get Representative Binks some water?
Yes, Master.
Adam gives it.
I gotta get water for my hero.
Apprentices, right?
Right.
But hey, listen, I know this isn't exactly the Jedi way, but his born day is coming up. Would you mind?
Adam pulls out a Jar Jar sticker and a marker from his Jedi robes.
Of course, anything for the Jedi.
Jedi's bow.
Citizens of Naboo.
Then throw off their robes and bust out their lightsabers.
Y'all ready for Binks?
Disco lights shine and a righteous jock jam blasts from the sound system as Adam and Fern spark off their sabers and perform a sick Jedi floor routine. Flippy dips and saber swings galore. It's like Cirque du Soleil meets Duel of the Fates for 5 unbroken minutes. At the climax of their routine, they lock sabers and fireworks shoot out of them and explode in the sky in the shape of Jar Jar. The crowd cheers. This scene gets cut from the movie. Adam and Fern slam a Predator high five to trot off the stage.
Fuck yeah.
Should re-elect Misa to the Galactic Senate. And in Misa's first term, Misa can't do this.
Jar Jar marches off the stage.
The two Jedis look around and slowly take off their hood, ready to fill in the time with the
A frantic stage manager checks her
vamp,
mic and
vamp.
Gives her, like, the vamp, like, run, like, go, hand signal, universal hand signal.
And the jock jam starts up and is abortively shut down. He stomps over to Nate 38, who moves to block the trash can.
No.
In the background, the two Jedi shoot t-shirts from a t-shirt into the appreciative waiting crowd. Misa, sorry, Nate 38, but Misa have to.
Think of the polling. Won't someone please think of the polling?
Jar Jar pushes past her, pulls the fish out of the trash can, steps back up to the podium, and waves the fish in front of the crowd.
Look at this in fish. My friend Captain Croquet can't sell this fish. She can't eat this fish. Her whole village is starving. And all because of this...
Suddenly the fish gives a post-mortem belch and barfs up a hideous goo onto Jar Jar's face. The crowd bursts into delighted laughter. Jar Jar plops onto the ground and sighs with relief. But then a shadow falls over his face to the sound of cracking stone. He looks up and sees statue Jar Jar toppling over, about to crush him. He screams and covers his face. And then the statue stops midair. Jar Jar looks up confused, then gasps along with the awestruck crowd at Fernge Widow, holding the massive statue aloft with the power of the Force. The crowd cheers. Jar Jar gives Fernge a thumbs up. Then Fernge flinches and staggers back. Confused, he looks down and sees a smoking blaster hole in his chest. Jar Jar gawks in horror as Fernge drops to the ground. Jar Jar looks down at Fernge, whose eyes are glazing over fast. Through the chaos, Jar Jar sees Adam, enraged, blocking a flurry of blaster fire as he battles his way through the clone troopers towards his slain Padawan. The pandemonium overwhelms Jar Jar. The screaming crowds, the firing blasters, the hum of a lightsaber suddenly cut short as the clone troopers rush him offstage and into a security ship floating nearby. As the engine roars and the ship blasts off, shell-shocked Jar Jar trembles with fright. An ominous atonal alert noise drones 3 times, and the symbol of the Republic plays on a flickering holographic video.
This is an emergency holonet transmission from the Galactic Republic. For reasons unknown, the Jedi Order has attacked Republic soldiers and citizens across the galaxy. The Supreme Chancellor is in stable condition and will address the Republic soon to discuss the ongoing Jedi crisis.
Jar Jar, Padme, and Senator Bail Organa sit in their floating repulsor pod in the sprawling Senate chamber.
The attempt on my life has left me scarred and deformed, but I assure you my resolve has never been stronger. The war is over. The Separatists have been defeated, and the Jedi Rebellion has been foiled.
A cheer goes up from the audience. As they applaud, we push in on Jar Jar, looking conflicted and confused.
In order to ensure our security and continuing stability, the Republic will be reorganized into the First Galactic Empire for a safe and secure society which I assure you will last for 10,000 years.
There is a loud, sustained cheer from the Senate.
Ooh, that's a lot of years. I love all those years.
So this is how liberty dies, to thunderous applause. Suddenly the door behind them opens. 4 sinister-looking troopers stand in the hall. One of them motions Jar Jar, Padme, and Bail Organa to come with them.
Your presence is required. By the Emperor.
The medics say with time they can restore much of the cosmetic damage. But I say let my visage be a warning to the galaxy about the cruelty of the Jedi. Plus, it's not like I was a hollow screen star to begin with.
What's on your mind, Your Excellency? Holiness? I don't know how to address a...
Emperor Palpatine will suffice. Now then, we have much to discuss, starting with the Senate. Henceforth, it shall be an advisory body, with direct authority placed in the hands of planetary governors. Senator Amidala, as a former queen yourself...
As a former queen of Naboo, I will play no part in our people's subjugation as your hand-picked governor.
My dear senator, all I was going to say was, as a former queen yourself, what do you think of Jar Jar for governor?
Misa?
Him?
Misa might not be the best person for the job.
That is why it must be you. Those who seek not the crown are the best to carry its burdens.
And the easiest to manipulate. You don't want a leader, you want a puppet, a useful clown to do your every bidding.
Oh, I can't say I won't twist the governor's arm a little, but I think you underestimate our Gungan friend.
I'm sorry, Jar Jar. I didn't mean that you were...
A useful clown?
Again... I apologize.
All I ask is that you sleep on it.
Bail and Padme head for the door. Jar Jar lingers for a moment, nervous. Palpatine makes a flick of the wrist, and the door slams shut with Padme and Bail on the other side.
Oh, darn that door. It's got a mind of its own. Now then, let us talk plainly, Jar Jar. I am offering you the kind of power most politicians only dream of. Think of the people you could help.
Jar Jar ponders this sincerely.
Take, for instance, the pollution of the Andravia River.
You still know about that?
Alas, there's not much a junior representative could do about it, other than to submit a proposal to forward a motion to allow for a delegation to review the matter.
But if Misa was governor...
Then you, sir, could just snap your fingers.
Hey, Palpatine, fucking back off. That's jacked up that you would... Make fun of the way I speak, motherfucker.
Excuse me, Jar Jar, that was slightly problematic of me, but I like that we can call each other out on this stuff.
He snaps his fingers and the doors open again.
Like I said, give it a good night's sleep. I look forward to working with you, Governor.
It's West Wing walk and talk time, baby.
Yeah.
Padme, Jar Jar, and Bail walk briskly through the Senate halls.
Whatever he offered you in there is not worth the price.
But Yusa says we can fix the pollution.
What pollution?
In the Andravea, Yusa don't know?
All Palpatine wants is power, and it's clear he'll do anything now to get it.
But don't Yusa need power to help the people?
His kind of power never helps, it only corrupts.
But then what should Misa do?
Padme and Bail share a look. Bail turns to Jar Jar and whispers, "Resist."
Battle lines are being drawn, Jar Jar, between darkness and light. I hope and pray we find ourselves fighting on the same side.
With that, Padme and Bail step out of the building onto the street. Jar Jar lingers in the entrance, wearing a pensive frown and a furrowed brow. Jar Jar lets out a weary sigh. He takes a step into the street, and a large cargo hauler lurches to a halt in front of him. The door pops open, and two hulking droids pop out.
What the? Yeah!
The droids grab Jar Jar and throw him into the hauler. The droids pin Jar Jar to the wall and call out to the hauler's driver.
Passing secure.
What do you so want? Who so are you?
The driver speaks with a gruff, authoritative, yet somehow ethereal voice.
Who am I? I'm someone who saved your life. Someone you owe a debt to.
The driver turns to face Jar Jar. Jar Jar gasps and dumbstruck off, for the face staring back at him is...
And I'm here to collect.
The ghost of Qui-Gon Jinn.
Will be revealed when we arrive.
Arrive where? Where are we so going?
Qui-Gon points out the window. To the Jedi Temple.
To the scene of the crime.
The grand halls of the Jedi Order lay in ruins, pockmarked by blaster fire and saber burns. A ghostly silence hangs in the air.
I had a vision of a great evil befalling the galaxy, and my soul would know no peace until I stopped it. In the end, it was the screams that guided me home.
Qui-Gon closes his eyes in concentration and raises his hands. All around him, a haunting tableau appears.
The younglings, Jar Jar. 200 children slaughtered by a Jedi's blade.
Jar Jar's eyes well with tears. His voice breaks.
Who's the could have done this? Who?
Qui-Gon motions to a hooded figure standing amidst the chaos, a lightsaber in his grip.
They were killed on the orders of the Dark Lord of the Sith by his new apprentice, Darth Vader. Or as we once knew him.
Suddenly the figure jump cuts to a new position. The saber, held high for a killing blow, illuminates his face, the face of Anakin Skywalker.
Annie? No.
The calamity I foresaw has already begun. A Sith Lord rules the galaxy. Beside him stands the most powerful Jedi ever known. And the only person who can stop them...
Jar Jar looks up. Qui-Gon stares right at him.
...is me.
But Yusa's just a ghost.
I know. Oh, well, that's where you come in.
Misa?
Palpatine has outwitted his rivals at every turn, but you? He'll never see you coming.
Coming to do what?
To uncover his schemes, to foil his plots.
This isn't too much for Misa, Qui-Gon. You still want Padme or Bail Organa. They still resisting the Empire. Misa can get them right now.
Jar Jar turns to leave. Qui-Gon appears in front of him.
No! They can never know. The Resistance is still in its infancy and full of spies. For their safety and yours, our allies must believe you have become the Emperor's most loyal servant.
But how can Misa serve the people who did this?
He gestures to the carnage around them.
You would do it because you must. Because no one else can. And because the galaxy needs you, Jar Jar.
Jar Jar drops to his knees, overwhelmed by what's being asked of him. Qui-Gon's voice softens as he kneels down next to Jar Jar.
But you will not serve him, Jar Jar. You'll play the part of his bumbling sycophant. But in truth, you'll become something more.
Jar Jar scoffs.
What, a hero? Haven't Yusa heard? Misa already the hero of Naboo.
No, Jar Jar. Not a hero. A phantom menace.
Jar Jar looks up and...
You son of a bitch.
It is my great honor to introduce Governor Jar Jar Binks.
Applause and camera flashes fill the air. Jar Jar masks the pain in his soul behind one of his big, goofy trademark smiles.
Thank you. Misa's so thrilled to serve the people. Misa mean the Emperor as the first planetary governor of Naboo.
The reporters fire off a flurry of questions at Jar Jar.
It has been 1 week since the sudden death of your colleague, Senator Amidala. Why were the medical droid's memories wiped? What is the Emperor hiding? How did Padme Amidala die?
Reporter number 4 stops abruptly. He tries to force out the words, but they won't come. He claws at his throat. He's choking. A murmur of alarm breaks out in the crowd as a door slides open and deep robotic breathing cuts through the air. Darth Vader, early 20s. His force-choking hand outstretched.
Dear friends, allow me to introduce another new member of my administration. Please meet my personal lieutenant and supreme commander of the Imperial Forces, Lord Darth Vader.
This conference is over. Any further questions will be answered outside.
He swipes his arm to the side, and reporter number 4 goes flying out the window. The reporters scream and flee from the room. Jar Jar watches the whole spectacle in terror. Jar Jar quickly hides his melancholy behind another polite smile.
It's a bombad honor, Lord Vader.
Vader's mask is as unreadable as ever, as is his deep, stoic voice.
The honor is mine, Governor Binks.
Your transport to Naboo awaits you, Governor. As for us, we have some tedious state business to attend to. Come, Vader. The Red Council awaits.
But I don't wish to attend this meeting. I wish to meditate.
Vader, stop being a dick and listen to me. I'm your boss. You're supposed to do stuff that I say.
But you told me I could go play with my friends at the mall. I was supposed to meet my friends skateboarding by the Sbarro. Dwayne told me about this cool skate spot that he had found by those waterfalls, and you said that I could do it if my chores were done.
Now, Vader, I'll take you to GameStop later, and you can pick out something for the Nintendo Switch.
Jar Jar once again stands in front of a big-ass processing plant, delivering a speech to a crowd of onlookers. He lifts up a big, ugly fish.
Look at this fish. This one may seem like an ordinary glub-glub, but in fact, it's gonna be the lifeblood of the Empire.
Jar Jar squeezes the fish, and a viscous oil seeps from its hideous pores.
Because when Yusa squeeze a glub-glub, Yusa get glub-glub oil, and if Yusa got glub-glub oil, you can thermo-lubricate an ion engine. And when Yusa can thermo-lubricate an ion engine, Yusa get Star Destroyers.
Jar Jar points dramatically to the sky, where 3 Star Destroyers appear out of nowhere above the plant. The crowd goes absolutely fucking bananas. Jar Jar gives a playful, debonair grin.
On Corellia, they'sa make the ships. On Naboo, we'sa make a move.
Fireworks, club music, the factory rumbles to life. 3 huge banners unfurl from the Star Destroyers that say, we'sa make a move. But at the edge of the crowd, a solitary hooded figure stares at Jar Jar and balls their Gungan fists in rage. He sees the robed figure holding a smoking rocket launcher. A gust of wind blows the hood off their face. It's Croquet!
Governor Binks, your approval rating is sky high. Weesa Make a Move is the song of the summer. The people are so fired up, they've completely forgotten that the Wartime Production Act has suspended their civil rights.
Jar Jar is not thrilled to hear this, but tries to play along.
Oh,
Good, good.
The Emperor is very pleased. He sent you a fruit basket, along with that man from the press conference.
Nate 38 hands Jar Jar a fruit basket and nods at Darth Vader, looming in the hallway, just straight up staring at a big, beautiful portrait of Padme that hangs on the wall.
Governor Binks.
Jar Jar jumps in fright. Vader nods to him from an awkward distance down the hall.
Ah! Hello?
Darth Vader.
Yes, Darth Vader. So nice to see you again. Welcome to Naboo. Would you like some fruit?
I do not eat fruit. Excuse me.
Darth Vader walks past them towards his office.
The power of fruit is insignificant compared to the power of the Force.
Literally my favorite Darth Vader line ever is Vader saying, excuse I do me. Not eat fruit. Is literally the best Vader line of all time. I like to think it's Jar Jar's like, would you like some fruit? And we just do like that war flashback of that floating apple with a bite in it floating between him and Padme. He like shakes it off. He's like, I do not eat fruit.
Misa never wanted this life, Nate 38.
I know how you feel, Governor.
Yusa do?
I... never mind. It's not my place to say, sir. I'm just a droid after all.
Yusa more than just a droid to me, Nate. Yusa my friend.
Thank you, sir. Well, just between us friends, I always wanted to be a TIE fighter pilot.
Really? But aren't you Yusa programmed to do math and statistics?
Dogfighting is math and statistics! Which way will the enemy turn? How will they react to incoming fire? What angle of approach at what speed is the ideal vector for a strafing run? I could make those calculations and more in the blink of an eye, but they don't let droids into the Imperial Navy, and they're rather rude when you ask.
Misa, sorry, Nate. It's not fair.
We statisticians have a saying, Governor. The statistical probability of a fair result of inversely proportionate to the heteroscedasticity of natural outcomes in a given contrapositive set.
Jar Jar nods sagely, pretending to understand what this means.
I see. These are soldiers' hands, Qui-Gon. Misa should be out there fighting the good fight, like Croquet.
Croquet?
She's the leader of the resistance in the city.
Qui-Gon's eyes blaze with sudden fire.
You know the leader of the guerrilla resistance?
Yeah. Oh, maybe Misa can get her to help us.
Qui-Gon rubs his beard, already plotting his next move.
Yes. Yes, she'll be quite useful. When you hand her on a silver plate to Vader...
What?
It's the only way to get you into those meetings.
But Croquet is on our side. She's a hero.
Then she can die like one.
Jar Jar steps back, regarding Qui-Gon with a quiet horror.
I sense your feelings. You think I'm a monster. That I've gone to the dark side. Maybe I have. Maybe war itself is the way of the dark side.
He softens and looks imploringly at Jar Jar.
But this is war, Jar Jar. And Croquet knows that. You think she wouldn't lay down her life to put a spy at the Emperor's table to help save millions? What would you do, soldier?
Misa would die for the people Misa love.
Ah, Lord Vader, Governor Binks. To what do Misa owe the pleasure?
Croquet Seal, you are under arrest for conspiring against the Empire.
Misa, see. And Husa accused me of this crime?
Misa saw you at the factory, Croquet.
Then I guess we still know whose side Yusa on, General. Did Yusa put up a fight at least? Did Yusa beat it out of you? Or did Yusa smile when you stabbed your people in the back?
Naboo is proud to serve the Emperor, and Misa proud to serve Naboo.
Look around you, Jar Jar. Look at what Yusa doing. Yusa fought their war for this?
Misa fought for the good of the galaxy. Misa's still fighting. Not just for Naboo, but for everyone. Yusa the traitor, Croquet. Yusa the one that can't see that peace only comes through strength.
Do you know why Misa let you see me at the factory, Jar Jar? Either Yusa would say nothing, and Misa would have had an ally. Or Yusa would tell Vader and lead him straight to us.
Death to the Empire. But just as she pulls the trigger, Vader merely looks in her direction, and a crossbeam falls from the ceiling and slams into her, pinning her to the ground. Her resistance comrades, all dead, lie in smoking heaps throughout the room. Vader steps up to Croquet. She looks up at him with burning hatred. He aims his saber between her eyes and twists a knob on the hilt with his thumb.
Vader! Vader! Vader, stop! Lord Vader! Annie! Annie to her alive! Lord Vader, Misa think it'd be better to take her in alive. Shisa could be useful to the Emperor, right?
As you wish.
You said his name?
Maybe Misa didn't hear me. Maybe he's already forgot.
Governor Binks!
The sudden booming voice of a droid causes Jar Jar to yelp. Qui-Gon vanishes.
Lord Vader requests your company at his residence this evening for dinner.
Jar Jar, dressed in a dapper outfit, a bottle of wine under his arm, rings the doorbell of Vader's elegant Theed residence. The door buzzes open. In stark contrast to the elegant exterior, Vader's decor is like a depressing sci-fi bachelor pad.
Oh my God.
A jet-black sofa sits too close to a massive hollow screen.
Hello?
One moment.
A flush. Darth Vader emerges from the bathroom.
Forgive the untidy state of my residence. I've had many pressing matters to attend to.
But the live pod race playing on his holo screen tells a different story. With a hasty flick of the wrist, Vader changes the channel to a map of the Empire's latest military operations.
Please sit.
Vader has laid out a bunch of to-go boxes from a high-end restaurant on a huge bare table.
I hope it is to your liking.
Are Yusa not having any?
This neutral sludge shall provide my sustenance.
A straw juts out of Vader's helmet. He hooks it up to the canister. A hideous slurping sound begins as the sludge is sucked up through the straw.
So, Kroke, has Shisa proven useful?
Somehow Vader's cyborg apparati allow him to slurp and speak simultaneously.
Most useful.
Oh, good.
So, you know my secret, Jar Jar. I wish to know how you came to know this.
Well, Misa didn't really know. Misa just kind of guessed, and...
The slurping stops.
Misa not going to tell anybody, honest.
As long as we're being honest, it is good to see you, old friend.
It is?
My allegiance to the Emperor has brought me power, but still, I am lonely.
Darth Vader stands up and walks to the window. Vader produces something from inside his cloak.
Do you remember this? It was the first gift I ever gave to Padme. I wonder... What would she think of me now?
Jar Jar can't help but step towards his old friend. He begins to reach out a comforting hand. Then he sees Vader's reflection in the window, not gazing at the Jabur snippet, but staring right at him, waiting to see how he'll react. A chill runs down Jar Jar's spine as he realizes he's being played.
The time for wondering was before Yusa killed the younglings, Vader. If Yusa feeling this way, maybe Yusa too weak to be Supreme Commander. Get it through what's left of your skull. Anakin Skywalker is dead. Yusa Darth Vader now, Okie Day.
I quite agree.
Vader raises his fist and crushes the Jabur snippet in his vice-like grip.
It seems I was wrong to doubt you, Governor. You'll be a fine addition to the Red Council. Come, we have much to discuss.
Vader whispers in Jar Jar's ear.
When the time comes, follow my lead.
Governor, before you are admitted to this council, you will answer a series of questions.
She snaps her fingers and a 3D schematic appears floating before Jar Jar. It's the Death Star!
This weapon is as of yet unnamed, which brings us to you.
Vader, looming over Jar Jar, unfurls a little piece of paper and reads from it.
I will now read the list of candidate names. You'll respond to each name with one of the following options. Strongly approve, somewhat approve, somewhat disapprove, strongly disapprove, or no opinion. Answer truthfully, or the machine shall reveal your deception. Let us begin.
Confusion mixes with the fear on Jar Jar's eyes. Is this really the test?
The Doom Star.
Strongly approved.
Ding! A green light chimes on Jar Jar's chair.
The Death Orb.
Somewhat approved?
Ding! Another green chime.
The Kill-O-Sphere.
Darth Vader puts like some extra juicy baritone stank on his voice when he says this. He also gives Jar Jar a discreet thumbs up. Jar Jar's eyes shoot wide in terror.
To remind you, this is a big sphere that kills things.
Careful, Vader.
Jar Jar gulps. The council waits with bated breath. Vader's stare practically burns into his forehead.
This is strongly approved.
A red light buzzes on the chair.
Somewhat approved?
Another red light. Vader seethes. The council members can barely contain their laughter.
Speak truthfully, Governor, or suffer the consequences.
Strongly disapprove.
Ding! The light turns green. Vader clenches his fists in rage.
It's fine. I disagree with whatever. It's not like you could come up with something better.
Misa no expert, but death is scarier than Doom, and Star is cooler than Orp. Maybe the Death Star?
A pregnant pause as the council members all stare at Jar Jar, then burst out laughing.
That's the stupidest name I've ever heard.
Oh no, our planet is doomed! The Death Star is here!
Yes, it is very bad. I quite agree.
Okay, Jar Jar, okay, you're in. On to new business. How do the trials for the Death Star laser going?
To further develop our prototype, we must see its destructive capacity in a live fire environment. Yet finding such an environment is complicated by our need for secrecy.
Allow me to present a solution to this dilemma. The Gungan known as Croquet Seal proved highly resistant to our interrogation droids, but her mind was an open book to me through the power of the Force.
Eye rolls and annoyed looks from the Council. There he goes about the Force again.
As I suspected, Croquet and her insurgents are a part of the Galactic Terrorist Network known only by this symbol. Several key leaders of this network are hiding out in the city of New Centrif. I propose we test our laser on New Centrif and blame the destruction on this network.
Clever Lord Vader.
You really expect the public to believe some ragtag anarchists have that much power?
The people will believe whatever we want them to believe, but the story must come from the right source.
Someone credible. Someone like... are you guys thinking what I'm thinking? Jar Jar Binks! That's what I'm talking about! Synergy! Unlimited synergy! Dr. Lindo, how soon can we get the Death Star laser ready?
Just to clarify, we're not actually calling it the Death Star, right?
I don't know, it's kind of growing on me.
And then Jar Jar turns to the camera and shrugs.
And goes, are you so freaking kidding me?
All set for our spur of the moment trip to New Centrif. Oh dear, you're upset. Whatever is the matter, Governor?
Jar Jar wipes his tears away.
It's a nothing, Nate 38. Misa fine.
Nate 38 bows politely and turns for the door.
Wait.
Yes, sir?
If Yusa could do something good, but only by doing something bad, would Yusa do it?
I am only a polling droid, sir. I am not programmed to process ethical quandaries. I can tell you that in a double-blind sample poll, 67% of voting age Naboolians at least somewhat agree with the statement, the end justifies the means. Does that help you, sir?
Not really. Never mind. Thanks, Nate.
If I may be so bold, Governor, I can also tell you that when asked to select the quality they admire most in Jar Jar Binks, 89% of your supporters said, I trust him to do what he thinks is right.
It's not that simple, though. Misa can't just wave my hand and do whatever Misa wants.
Begging your pardon, sir? But you are the Governor of Naboo. The Empire grants you wide discretion to handle planetary affairs. Not to be crass, but you pretty much can do whatever you want.
Hey, Misa right. Misa the Governor of Naboo. Misa can't do what I want. Misa was elected to do what I want. But what do Misa want to do? Misa don't know. That's too complicated.
I hate to be a bother, but we do have to hurry if we want to catch that shuttle to New Centrif.
Misa need more time, Nate. If only Misa could...
Jar Jar gasps as an epiphany strikes him like lightning.
Misa need more time.
An obsidian elevator door slides open. A yawning Palpatine holding a mug of coffee steps into his cavernous throne room. Hey, fellas. Don't work too hard. Just kidding. Palpatine plops in his throne and takes a sip from his mug. Let's see what's on fire in the Empire.
Public execution of the rebel leader Croquet Steel will be broadcasted to the galaxy live in 2 days, and the Emperor himself will be here in person to watch.
That insolent fool!
A crudely drawn 3D hologram of a mission plan appears in the room. Jar Jar leans back on his desk and folds his arms and gives Palpatine and Vader a cocky grin.
So, what's Yusa think? Pretty crafty thinking, huh?
Lightning erupts from Palpatine's fingertips into Jar Jar's body.
You insolent, impudent wretch!
Jar Jar twitches as sparking strings of electricity tug him like a marionette.
You dare defy my commands! I do not tolerate your existence to hear your thoughts, Governor! I demand obedience!
He clenches his hands. The ropes of lightning twist, and Jar Jar's own hand seizes his neck.
But if you are unwilling to play the puppet, it's time to cut your strings.
Excellent. Commence passage through the planet core.
The planet core.
The planet core.
The planet core.
The core.
The planet core.
The planet core.
The core.
The planet core.
A small device sits on the tunnel floor, illuminated by its blinking red light. The pilot gets an error message on her dashboard. She taps the communicator.
Command? Command? Do you read?
On hearing this, Jar Jar slips a small button out of his sleeve and into his palm and presses it.
What the hell is that?
Through the window, they see a massive air bubble expand violently in front of them. The transport crashes into the dry, rocky ground on the other side. Alarms blare. A shifty look comes over Jar Jar.
What happened?
Hit some kind of air pocket. Stay put. We're checking it out.
The pilot and convoy commander climb out of the ship. Jar Jar grabs the keys and rushes to release Croquet's restraints.
Misa busting you out of here. Can Yusa move?
But to his surprise, Croquet begins to laugh.
Croquet?
Yusa timing is impeccable. Her eyes turn to the window. Jar Jar follows her gaze. 6 resistance fighters burst through the transport doors, revealing Croquet and an astonished Jar Jar on the other side.
Wow, this is lucky. Yusa busting Croquet out. Misa busts and Croquet out.
Croquet snatches Jar Jar's blaster and points it at his head. The resistance fighters draw their rifles on him as well. Jar Jar gulps and helpfully repeats the last thing he said.
Misa busts and Croquet out.
The fighters shove Jar Jar out of the transport and onto the ground. He throws up his hands, pleading.
Wait, wait! Misa trying to help you. Misa double agent. Misa been taking down Palpatine from the inside. They said know about your hidden base in Usentrif. They're gonna blow up the whole city and blame it on Yusa. Misa stalled them, bought a few days by announcing the execution. But if Misa don't stop them, thousands of people are gonna die.
Croquet sneers.
How can Misa possibly trust you?
Jar Jar sighs with resignation.
Misa don't have to. Misa could kill me right now and Misa wouldn't blame you. But before Misa do, take this.
Jar Jar offers her a data pad. He presses a button. A mini hologram of a laser cannon schematic appears.
Misa got everything you need to stop the attack and save the city. If Misa wants to kill me, fine. But don't let anyone else die.
He locks eyes with Croquet, pleading. Her icy features soften ever so slightly. Croquet takes the data pad, then knocks Jar Jar out with a swift punch. Jar Jar blinks groggily as he takes in his surroundings, an underground rebel bunker. At the center of the room, a ragtag group of partisans and guerrilla fighters huddle around a holographic projection of the Death Star prototype, a floating weapons platform with a massive laser cannon at its center.
While the Senate wrings their hands, the Empire will turn this prototype into a full-fledged planet killer.
Any assault on that platform by our meager forces would be suicide.
Not necessarily. Misa studied the plans. There's no way in while the deflector shield is up. But they still gotta lower it when they fire that laser.
And that's our in. When they strike, we strike!
What about Usentrif?
Everyone in the room looks at Jar Jar, except Croquet, her eyes probing the holographic plans.
There's thousands of people in this city. Yusa gonna save them, right?
Croquet gives an ironic chuckle. Now Yusa care about the people, huh?
Yusa supposed to be the good guys. That's why Misa did this. Yusa can't just let them die.
Croquet snarls, her patience wearing thin. And what would Yusa propose we do about that, Governor?
Misa let you down, Croquet. Misa hurt you. Misa never forgive myself for that, but Misa truly sorry. Yusa got every reason to hate me and no good reason to believe what Misa's saying, but that's okay. Because Misa believe in you. Because we spilled the same blood in the same mud.
Damn.
And that Croquet I know, if Misa saw a way to save a life, to protect the innocent, she took it. No matter what the odds. No matter what the risks. It's what Yusa do. It's who Yusa are. What Misa do now, right now, is who Misa are. Misa can't read the future. Misa don't know if Misa gonna live or die. But Misa know this. If Yusa won't even try to save a single city, Yusa never gonna save a whole galaxy.
Croquet stares at Jar Jar for a long beat. She gets up and grabs a hatchet from the table. If Yusa playing us, Misa gonna kill you myself. With one deft strike, she cuts the chain shackling Jar Jar to the wall. He looks up at her, tears well in Croquet's eyes. But Misa really hope Yusa not playing us, General. Croquet salutes Jar Jar. He smiles and salutes back to his old friend. She turns to the room and gives that wild warrior's grin. We still got 24 hours to save this city. Let's get to work. Literally ended the last one saying, let's get to work. We still got 24 hours to save this city. Let's get to work. And with that, the rebels spring into action. So this feels like
a montage.
A heist. Oh, boy.
Montage.
Heist montage. Heist montage. There's a guy in a box. They're sneaking him in. It's a Star Wars box. It's a heist montage. There's a shot of a bunch of them at a cafe. It's a Star Wars cafe. They're looking at their plans and they're drawing things. And there's maybe a shot of one of them in a hard hat with a high-vis vest. What is he doing? You'll find out after this heist montage. Heist montage. One will look at a screen and some blueprints and be nodding and be happy about what's going on.
Oh, shit.
The shit writes itself, dude. You're done. We're done.
Jar Jar speaks before Vader, the Emperor, and the holograms of the Red Council.
Misa time with the resistors has been most fruitful. Croquet has revealed the existence of an even bigger rebel base on another planet, but she's not saying which one. Croquet doesn't care if Misa lives or dies, but Misa cares about Naboo. We should bring her to the laser, show her its power, tell her Misa gonna blow up Usentrif if Misa doesn't talk. Misa gonna crack like a wobble nut.
Impressive. A cunning plan, Governor.
I don't know. What's to stop her from just saying the base is on some random planet somewhere? And then we go all the way out to, I don't know, Dantooine, and then there's nothing there. We look like idiots. Still, you raise an intriguing point, Jar Jar. The destructive power of this laser is nothing compared to the fear it would strike in those who behold it.
Why go to all the trouble of unleashing its destruction on New Centrif and making the rebels seem powerful?
Jar Jar's eyes grow with worry as he realizes the tables are turning on him.
No, I think not. Let Croquet Seal and her rats die like the vermin they are in their nest. We shall announce New Centrif's destruction and let the whole galaxy see what happens to any city that harbors the enemies of our glorious empire.
But now Weesa can't get Croquet onto the platform, and the Emperor is going to be there, so there's going to be way more security.
The stakes are higher, but so is the prize. If Weesa pull this off, Weesa can take out Palpatine. Weesa have to find a way.
Any of our fighter craft would be shot down before they made it anywhere near that platform.
What if Weesa steal Imperial fighters?
From where? Security at their shipyards is impenetrable.
And even if Weesa do all that, flight control is bound to notice three extra ships in the air. The second Weesa break formation in an attack, Weesa'd get blown to space dust.
Jar Jar rubs his temples, despairing.
Ooh, this again complicated.
Jar Jar gives an impassioned speech outside the front gates of a starfighter manufacturing plant.
For Yusa tireless efforts, for Yusa commitment to excellence, and for Yusa hitting the manufacturing yield this quarter, Misa making Yusa the Starfighter Factory of the Month.
Confetti cannons fire, music blasts, more triumphant banners fall all over the place. A raucous cheer goes up from the workers. As a party rages out front, Croquet and her partisans lurk in the bushes out back. A door pops open. Jar Jar, disheveled, quickly waves them forward.
Go, go, go.
The rebels sneak into the factory and Jar Jar shuts the door.
The plan is set. Yusa know your objectives. The operation begins. Now.
With that, they spring into action. Croquet turns to Jar Jar. Weesa radio silent from here on in. No contact, just trust. Good luck up there, Governor. And may the Force be with you. With great solemnity, they shake hands. Jar Jar takes the turbo lift up to his residence, exhausted, nervous, but ready to take on the world. Jar Jar enters the darkened hallway of his residence and hears the whine of blaster rifles charging up. He looks up in fright and sees three stormtroopers with rifles drawn, waiting in the shadows.
Governor Binks?
The lights turn on. The room is packed with Jar Jar's Imperial co-workers. He gasps.
Surprise!
The troopers fire their rifles, and a baffled Jar Jar gets covered in silly string.
What's all this?
Just our way of saying thank you.
For what?
Well, usually when a big project launches around here, the week building up to it is murder. Sometimes literally.
But thanks to your leadership, morale and employee satisfaction have never been higher.
Vader, looming awkwardly amidst the revelers, reads prepared remarks off of a piece of paper.
Therefore, in recognition of your achievements, this impromptu jubilee has been arranged at the request of the staff.
Don't be shy, Lord Vader. This whole thing was his idea.
It was? Vader nervously crumples his piece of paper.
I mean, it wasn't like a big deal. The ability to throw a party is insignificant next to the power of the Force. Punch anybody.
Well, tomorrow is a big day for the Empire. Tomorrow Weesa bringing down the rebels, but tonight Weesa bringing down the house.
A cheer goes up in the crowd and we kick off an Imperial party montage. Vader wanders through the party like the specter of death. Wherever he goes, conversation dies on the vine as people salute, down their drinks, and make excuses to leave his company. He settles for just trying not to look awkward and out of place. He pretends to browse Jar Jar's bookshelf. He waits in line for the bathroom. He hovers at the edge of big groups of people talking to Jar Jar, but never makes his move to jump in and say anything. He drinks and drinks and drinks. Cut to Vader, drunk off his ass, waves his red lightsaber around at a cornered, terrified group of partiers.
I didn't pick this color, you know? It just sort of gave it to me.
I think it suits you, Lord Vader.
Why? Why does it scare me? Because I scare you.
He punctuates these questions with a reproachful wag of the lightsaber, then stares morosely into the glow of the blade.
You know what the best messed up part is? I don't even know what color I want to be.
Lord Vader?
Governor Binks! The Gungan of the Owl. Are you enjoying the festivities?
Yeah, but Weesa thinking Weesa gonna call the night.
What? Why? Why? Everyone is having an excellent time. Are you not?
He glances around and finally clocks the terror in everyone's eyes.
I see. I've altered this vibe very well.
myself.
He steps forward and trips on his cape. Vader stumbles and drops his lightsaber. It plunges blade first through the floor, vanishing in an instant. We hear screams and crashing from below as the saber plunges through floor after floor.
I've got it.
He reaches a hand over the hole, pulls with the force, and the lightsaber, its blade pointing upwards, flies straight through Vader's robot arm. Vader clutches his sparking arm as Jar Jar helps his drunk ass towards a waiting landspeeder.
This is most unnecessary, Governor. I'm cool to pilot my own vehicle.
Still, Misa would feel better if Yusa let me drive you home.
No, not home. Take me to the Jedi Temple.
Why do you want to go there?
Just drive, Governor. I know you know the way.
Pitch dark in the temple. The front doors swing open.
Yusa sure Yusa want to...
Vader ignites his lightsaber, filling the room with a menacing red glow.
After you.
Jar Jar, terrified, steps into the temple. He turns and sees Vader kneeling at a meditation altar in the center of the room. He holds his saber out before him, head bowed in a reverent prayer ritual.
The last time I entered a Jedi temple was... that day on Coruscant.
Vader's fist grips tight around his lightsaber. He shuts it off, plunging the room into pitch darkness.
Why do you come to this place?
Misa told you. Misa...
Do not waste my time with falsehood, Governor. What have you found here?
Nothing. Misa swore...
Vader roars in rage. The temple shakes violently. A shaft of moonlight comes in through the hole, illuminating Vader, slumped over on the ground.
I see their faces. I hear their screams wherever I go. And not just the younglings. Every soul struck down in the Emperor's name. I hide from my sins in the cloak of the dark side, and every day I lose more of myself to the shadows. But you have seen and done just as much evil as I. And yet there is still light in you. I can feel it. Everyone can. I hoped that by coming here I could find that light, as you have. Yet I cannot. So I must ask you, old friend.
Vader presses a button on his suit, and his eye lenses drop away, revealing the teary, discolored, all-too-human eyes of Anakin Skywalker beneath them.
Do you see in my eyes a soul worth saving?
Tears fill Jar Jar's eyes. He opens his mouth to respond, but he can't find the words, until he sees the specter of Qui-Gon Jinn looming behind Vader in the shadows. Qui-Gon folds his arms and gives Jar Jar a hard, determined look.
Yes, Misa do.
Vader weeps. He hugs Jar Jar tight. Santa Claus weeps. He hugs Jar Jar tight. Jar Jar pats him on the back as he glares at Qui-Gon, who vanishes into the dark. A hungover Vader and Jar Jar stand in awkward silence next to each other as the Imperial March plays piped into the turbo lift speakers. Vader shifts and clears his throat.
Governor, about last night, I...
Jar Jar looks up at him hopefully, but just then the door swooshes open and in walks the Emperor, humming along to the Imperial March and adding his own homebrew lyrics.
Oh shit, here come the Imperials. Run and hide from the Imperials. Watch as they fight for the Emperor and die for the Emperor, for he is the Lord of the Sith. Ding.
Next to the technician, her colleagues crowd around that holographic projector Jar Jar hooked them up with. It displays a news program.
It appears that some new type of Imperial weapons platform has moved into the upper atmosphere above New Centrif. Though to what purpose, no one's quite sure.
Thanks, Freddy. One thing we can confirm, the platform's fighter escort consists of 147 brand new TIE fighters constructed right here in town at the New Center of Fighter Craft facility.
With that many fighters in tow, there must be a big VIP on board. Maybe even the illustrious Lord Vader himself.
Now on to sports.
147 fighters launched this morning, but... there are 150 in the sky right now.
That could just be a miscommunication.
Or it could be an attack.
What could three itty-bitty fighters do against a big battle station?
The prototype laser is vulnerable to attack in the moment before it fires. A direct hit on its thermal core could destroy the whole station.
This shit was in the memo, Jar Jar.
Did you not get my fucking memo, Jar Jar? The Emperor glares at Vader. Which is why someone suggested a massive fighter escort to protect us.
I have failed you, Master.
I have failed you, Master. Don't just stand there crying about it. Fix the problem, or I'll find a new apprentice who can.
A straight-up clipboard-slinging, walkie-talkie headset-wearing second assistant director hurries up to Vader, the Emperor, and Jar Jar.
Emperor Palpatine, you're doing makeup?
The Emperor turns his wrathful gaze onto Jar Jar and Vader.
10 minutes, gentlemen. Do not disappoint me.
He walks off with the second assistant director. Roke glances at the control tower from behind the tinted cockpit glass of her stolen TIE fighter.
Careful, boss. We're too close to that tower.
Negative.
Weesa gotta fly like Weesa got nothing to hide.
Command all squadrons to fly past this tower in single file formation. Tell them it's a parade.
Croke watches with alarm as all the TIE fighters around them form a single line and head towards the control tower.
A parade? 10 minutes before the attack?
You know how the Emperor loves to make an entrance.
Stay alert. Misa's smelling something sour in the water.
They fall into line with the parade of ships. Jar Jar, mind racing, scans the room and spots an empty control console in the corner. As everyone else stares out the window, he sneaks over to it.
Check your comms. I'm getting bursts of interference on our encrypted frequency.
Hang on. That pattern's too stable for interference. That's signal code. But it's just random letters. I can't make out the message.
Croke grins.
Those aren't random letters. That's native Gunganese.
Jar Jar, what's he saying?
T-R-A.
First up in their squad flies past the tower and sees Darth Vader looking out the window, hand outstretched.
It's a trap!
Vader closes his fist, and the Mon Calamari's fighter crushes and explodes.
No!
The Twi'lek pilot punches her afterburners and breaks formation.
Wait, don't!
Boom! In a split-second flash, a turbo laser on the platform locks onto the Twi'lek and blasts her ship to smithereens. Croke curses in fury. Vader spots Croke and begins to close his fist, and Qui-Gon Jinn appears in space right in front of him. Vader staggers back, astonished. With a blast of force power, Qui-Gon knocks him across the room and phases through the glass. Vader approaches Qui-Gon, regaining his poise.
So, you have learned the secret of the wills. Impressive. I look forward to prying them out of you.
If it's a lesson in dying, you see, I'm happy to oblige.
Qui-Gon force rips a bulkhead from the ceiling and launches it at Vader. Vader matches his power and the bulkhead stops in midair. A shockwave of colliding force energies blasts through the room, shattering screens and knocking people over. Vader barks an order to his staggered colleagues.
Get the governor to safety.
But my lord!
Now!
Vader locks eyes with an astonished Jar Jar.
I won't let him hurt you. Go.
The officer grabs Jar Jar and drags him out of the room, leaving Vader and Qui-Gon alone.
Now then.
With a sudden burst of speed, he lets go of the bulkhead and slices it in half with his lightsaber as it hurtles towards him. The bulkhead pieces crash on either side.
Show me your power, ghost.
Qui-Gon snarls with rage, force lifts a cloud of debris chunks and launches them at Vader. The battle is on! Right as they collide, Qui-Gon's ghost form dissipates and envelops Vader in a swirling vortex of light. We cut in close on Vader's eyes as reality bends around him. He falls backwards and crashes onto the stone floor of the Jedi Temple on Coruscant. He picks himself up from the ground and realizes to his shock that he is transformed back into Anakin Skywalker. He blinks in surprise.
Master Skywalker?
Anakin looks up and sees the younglings he slaughtered staring up at him with wide, fearful eyes.
What is this? An appeal to my conscience? I'm afraid you'll be disappointed.
Qui-Gon appears behind him.
You're a monster, Anakin. You have no conscience, but you're not here to feel guilty.
Suddenly, all the Padawans, dozens of them, ignite lightsabers and scowl at Anakin.
You're here to feel pain.
The younglings roar and attack Anakin en masse. Qui-Gon towers over him and sneers.
You feel it, don't you? The fear, the agony, a fraction of the suffering you caused, and a fraction of what you deserve.
Anakin hears the venom in his voice. Despite his wounds, a smile curls on his lips.
Your feelings betray you, Master. This isn't about my suffering.
He springs to his feet, his limbs suddenly restored, and clashes sabers with Qui-Gon, who staggers back in surprise.
It's about yours.
Qui-Gon blinks. He's standing before the Jedi Council. Qui-Gon's eyes race with fear, trapped in his own body as his voice speaks without his control, reciting the words of an old memory.
He's the Chosen One. You must see it.
Clouded this boy's future is.
Older Anakin appears behind Qui-Gon.
This is the moment that haunts you. The moment you sealed the galaxy's fate. They tried to warn you, but you wouldn't listen. They sensed the fear in me, but they never sensed the darkness in you. Your arrogance, your ambition. If only they had stopped you.
The council members stand up and light their sabers. Fear fills Qui-Gon's eyes.
They might still be alive.
Blinding flash, he teleports behind him, puts him in a headlock, and phases his fingers into Anakin's mind. The scene spins once more, and we find ourselves in interior Tatooine house, day. Young Anakin, smiling and happy, sits at the dinner table with Padme, Obi-Wan, Jar Jar, and his mom. Qui-Gon, still holding the adult Anakin from behind, forces him to bear witness to the scene.
It was love, Anakin. Love surrounded you, and you threw it away. Look at them. Your wife, your mother, your brother in arms. What would they say to you now?
What would they say to you? The queen you couldn't protect? The slave whose child you stole away? The Padawan who followed your dying request down a ruinous road?
Qui-Gon shudders unnerved. His eyes fall on young Anakin, who stares right at him.
Ah, yes. And the boy whose power you dared to mold. You failed us all. That's why you cling to this world. You don't care about saving it. You just don't want to die a loser. You're Qui-Gon Jinn, the brilliant Jedi warrior. You are gonna be the master of the Chosen One.
Anakin snatches the lightsaber off Qui-Gon's hilt and turns it on him, impaling him.
But in the end, you die the fool.
Qui-Gon gasps and collapses on the ground, a smoking hole in his stomach. Anakin looks down at him with smug satisfaction.
That's the problem with the light side, Master. It blinds you to the truth. That at the end of the day, we're all driven by our own desires. No one's truly selfless. Not me, not you, not...
Anakin stops, his brow wrinkles with confusion. He double-takes at the dinner scene and locks eyes with Jar Jar.
Hey, why is Jar Jar here?
To prove you wrong.
Anakin's eyes alight with alarm. As Qui-Gon's body goes slack, he drops to his knees and plunges into the old man's mind. In a flash, the scene changes around them. Anakin clutches the dying Qui-Gon and watches in horror as Qui-Gon's memories of Jar Jar flow in and out all around them. He watches Qui-Gon recruiting Jar Jar on Coruscant, arguing and scheming with him at the Jedi Temple on Naboo, and finally looming in the shadows, glaring at Jar Jar while a drunk, guilt-ridden Vader pours his heart out.
Do you see in my eyes a soul worth saving?
Anakin watches Jar Jar look to Qui-Gon before giving his answer.
Yes, Misa, do.
Anakin's face falls, stung with betrayal. He looks at Qui-Gon, who dies in his arms and fades away to nothingness. Anakin does a big old Vegeta DBZ power-up roar with rage. And Darth Vader comes to, flying with blinding speed. Vader draws his saber to his hand and ignites the blood-red blade.
Jar Jar and A-38 arrive at the obsidian door to Lord Vader's private chamber.
Okay, Lord Vader asked me to get something from his chambers. You should wait out here. Keep guard and watch for spies. Don't let anyone in here, okay?
Very well. A-38's arm morphs into a blaster rifle and she scans the perimeter of the hallway. Interior Vader's chamber, day. Jar Jar slips into the eerie metal and granite festooned private quarters of Darth Vader to access a command console. He flicks on a radio and turns to an encrypted frequency.
Okay.
Sparks and smoke fill Croquet's ship as she hangs on for dear life with the whole of the TIE fleet chasing her around the station. Jar Jar, Misa and Big Bombad Poodoo, General.
Hang on, Misa's starting the firing sequence now.
He punches in a code at the command console. A loading bar appears and pushes towards 100%. The loading bar is replaced by a big red X. Jar Jar pounds the buttons on the console to no avail.
What? Oh, no.
The Emperor paces impatiently on the bridge of the weapons platform and watches enraged as Croquet evades his best pilots. 10 minutes until firing range, Emperor.
Where the hell is Vader, and why is that ship still in the air?
Your Excellence, the comm system in Lord Vader's chambers appears to be active. Shall I summon him?
No, I shall deal with him myself.
Croquet zooms towards the laser cannon's power core, still covered by armor shielding. Jar Jar, Misa in range!
Misa lost remote access to the laser. Yusa gotta wait till they fire it for real!
Misa not gonna make it that long!
Wait, there's a manual override on the laser itself! Misa gonna start the sequence by hand. Think you can hang on for a few more minutes?
Misa not gonna last more than a few seconds! Something off Croquet's bow catches her eye. Hope fills her face as she watches. The Resistance Fleet. A motley band of rusty fighters and freighters drop out of hyperdrive and join the fray. Scratch that! Misa gonna give them hell! Jar Jar grins. He cuts off his transmission and runs for the door.
What do you mean I'm not allowed in there?
Jar Jar skids to a halt as he hears the Emperor right outside, arguing with A-38.
Vader! Get your big metal butt out here or I'm killing this droid and blasting this door down! You've got 10 seconds! 9... 8...
Jar Jar's eyes fall on Vader's spare outfit hanging in the pod. Emperor Palpatine continues his countdown on the other side of the door.
7... 6... Well, what the hell am I doing? I'm the ruler of the galaxy.
He raises his hands and lightning sparks on his fingertips. The door swings open and Jar Jar, disguised in Darth Vader's outfit, stands in front of him.
Yes, Master?
Don't you yes, Master me. It's a mess out there. What are you doing sulking around your chambers in a moment like this?
I'm about to solve the problem most viciously. And with the power of evil, if you will excuse me...
Wait! You seem weird right now. Different somehow.
What do you suppose is going on with me, sir?
I don't know, but I sense something. Something strange.
Hey, where is Governor Binks?
Jar Jar. Why would Jar Jar be in the...
Maybe what you are sensing is me being sick of your shit.
Mate 38 gasps. The Emperor recoils in shock. Nobody's spoken like this to him in years.
What did you say to me?
I said get out of my way, old man. How am I supposed to crush uprisings and strike fear into the hearts of Yusa and Amizel Yusa constantly micromanaging everything I do?
Vader, did you just say Yusa?
How can you run a whole galaxy if you don't even trust your own co-workers?
Okay, sheesh, fair enough. Get it done and meet me on the bridge.
The Emperor walks off, muttering under his breath.
Don't have to be a dick about it.
She watches the TIE fighters duke it out with the Resistance forces.
Foolish humans! They'll never beat the Resistance with those maneuvers!
Nate 38 gives a glum sigh and paces the room.
If only I could, something catches her eye. Hello, what have we here? A remote piloting system. Remarkable!
Nate 38 gasps as the console lights up before her eyes. She glances once more at the star battle raging out the window.
Dare I defy the Empire? To save the Empire? No, I can't. Know your place, Nate 38. That's what they say. Know your place.
Connection complete. You're now in control of the TIE Mark Vader.
What?
The screen displays a fighter's schematic, identical to the sleek, wingless TIE fighter she showed Vader earlier.
He stole my idea. This is my ship.
Suddenly, Nate 38's eyes glow red with rage.
This is my ship.
From the hangar bay comes the TIE Mark Nate. Two huge lightsabers spark to life where its wings should be and begins to spin.
Nate 38's lightsaber TIE fighter streaks out of the sky and slices his ship in two. Boom!
What the hell was that?
Boom! She slices through another ship from a seemingly impossible angle.
Someone's picking us up. Who's got eyes on him?
Attention, insurgent fighters. This is Nate 38 of the Imperial Fleet. Your odds of survival are 0%. Please deactivate your ship and prepare for destruction.
Annie, listen to me.
Vader raises a hand and closes his fist. Outside the window, Croaky's TIE fighter explodes. Jar Jar gasps in horror.
Anakin Skywalker is dead. You would have made an excellent Sith, Governor. Your talent for treachery is unrivaled.
Misa, sorry Misa had to lie to you, Annie. Misa truly am. But Misa had to stop this. It's the wrong. It's the evil. You should know it is, Annie. But Misa can still stop it. Together.
It is too late.
No, not yet. It's a never too late, Annie.
Vader stabs Jar Jar through the chest with his lightsaber.
Enough of your games, Jar Jar!
Jar Jar gasps and falls to his knees. He clutches at the smoking wound in his chest and looks up at Vader with sadness in his eyes.
You toyed with me from the start. You preyed on the last shred of goodness in my soul. I want to thank you for that, Governor. You've shown me where my weakness lies. All that remains.
Vader turns back to the prototype laser.
Is to burn it out.
At the blast site, people scream as the energy beam expands in all directions, destroying everything in its widening circle. Vader descends the stairs. His boots clank on the ground as he walks past Jar Jar, dying. Jar Jar looks through the transparent floor at the beam erupting from the station and incinerating the city below them, and then the electricity arcing to the prism from those orbs. A father, clutching two kids, flees from the massive wall of death amidst a panicked mob. Up ahead, a starship captain waits to take off. He sprints towards her as hard as he can, and a chunk of debris falls from a nearby building. The dad shoves his kids out of the way, but the debris lands on his leg, pinning him to the ground. The dad looks up at the towering wall of energy about to wipe him off the face of Naboo. He braces for death, but the wall of energy has stopped in its tracks. Alarms and warning lights flash. Vader turns around and sees Jar Jar holding onto one of the metal orbs, blocking its electricity with his body. Lightning courses through Jar Jar. His body shudders and smokes, but the prism, with half its power source removed, stops turning and the laser stops expanding. Despite the agony racking his body, Jar Jar manages to look up at Vader one last time and eke out his final words.
It's never too late.
The captain pulls the father out from the rubble. She helps him to his feet and guides him up the loading ramp where his two children are rolling. The orb that Jar Jar clings to grows even brighter. A surge of new energy blasts Jar Jar and sends him flying backwards. He slams into the control panel and crumples to the floor. The energy, no longer blocked by his body, arcs from the orb back to the prism and then rotates once more. The starship races through the sky, up and away, narrowly escaping death as all of New Centric is obliterated by the ever-expanding laser beam. There's a final flash of light. Then we see a smoldering, miles-wide scorch mark where the city used to be.
Today, the enemies of the Galactic Empire tremble in fright. Let all who would oppose us look now to the ashes of New Centrif and know the same fate awaits any city, any country, any planet that dares to hide them.
Grim footage of New Centrif's destruction plays on hollow screens before the citizens of the Empire. Palpatine stands next to a statue hidden under a black curtain.
But let all who stand with us take heart in the true source of Imperial power, the bravery of citizens like Governor Jar Jar Binks.
Contempt curdles into the faces of the civilians we've been watching.
When anarchist scum sought to destroy us, he gave up his life to save his emperor and defend a vital military asset.
From the outer rim to the inner core, anger simmers in the air.
And for that, we honor Jar Jar Binks as a hero of the Empire.
The curtain falls, revealing a statue of Jar Jar in full Imperial regalia, staring heroically into the distance. A defiant youth, her eyes blazing with rebellion, grabs a rock from the ground and hurls it at the statue. That general, furious, nods to a sharpshooter guarding the ceremony. The Emperor raises a hand to call them off, but blam! He's too late. The sniper guns down the young woman, and in an instant, the surly crowd becomes an enraged mob. Chaos and revolt consume cities and outposts all across the Empire. Amongst the rubble and wreckage, we catch glimpses of the rebel Starbird, rising like a phoenix from the flames. With ropes and clubs and fists, the crowd topples Jar Jar's statue and it smashes into the ground. A gunship descends from the sky. Nate 38, now wearing pilot's wings on her chassis, lands the ship on the steps. The loading ramp opens and Darth Vader marches out, flanked by elite shock troops. Vader looks out at the city before him, engulfed in fire and rebellion. Then he looks down at the statue of his fallen friend. Jar Jar seems to stare back up at him, asking a silent question through those stone, expressionless eyes. Vader turns away from Jar Jar, ignites his lightsaber, and descends the steps to join the battle below. As blaster fire and shouting fill the air, as flames turn the night sky orange, we push in on Jar Jar's toppled statue, look deep into his stone, stoic eyes, and cut to black.
Now this is truly the Star Wars.
Now this is attacking the clones.